Hello, everyone. Thank you for being here. We will begin the public hearing. And as we begin, I would ask that you stand, take your caps off, and enjoy the wonderful sound that Marie Pierre Fletcher is going to sing the national anthem for us. And she's in the back of the room because, in her case, that's the right place for her to be. And your sound will project forward and be better. So if you will stand. Talent on this island. All right, thank you all for being here, and obviously the public hearing concerning our budget is the first thing that we're going to deal with here tonight. The regular town meeting, monthly meeting, will follow the public hearing. And Mr. Hewitt, you would get us going here.
Yes, sir. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to the fiscal year 16-17 budget public hearing. As a preamble to tonight's hearing, I wanted to provide everybody with a recap of what the board and staff and the community have gone through in terms of the schedule and the process they followed in developing this year's budget. Since April, the board has held three meetings. The Canal Dredging Working Group has also convened during that time to assist with preparation of the canal dredging program. The departments provided inputs to me back the end of April. The budget message was provided to the public and the board at the end of May. That has been listed on the website since then. It brings us to tonight's public hearing. As a reminder, the budget must be adopted. That says 30 June, but technically it's 1 July. You've got to have a budget in place first day of the year. Simply put, what I will do is go through what the budget does, what it does not do, and a bit to the 10-year capital improvement plan, which is the first formally that I'm aware of for the beach. What this budget attempts to do, or what it must do, is that it appropriates our current debt services for the new town hall, the emergency operations center, and even though we don't hold the note on the county's capital sewer arrangement with us, we do hold some specific debt instruments for our sewer and also some installment financing for police department vehicles. It establishes a capital improvement plan. Again, it's a 10-year plan, with the first year of that plan being included in this year's operational budget. It also, this is a foot stomper, it decreases the general fund balance available down to approximately 19%. That's an important number. The Central Reach Project is the centerpiece of this budget, and it establishes it in a capital project fund, a discrete capital project fund. It escrows the Brunswick County, with Brunswick County, the projected $1.5 million debt service payment for the Central Reach Capital Project in accordance with the county-town interlocal agreement, which is on the board's agenda tonight for consideration. It makes the projected interest-only payment for the debt service in the Central Reach Project that will be incurred in the springtime of $192,000, with retaining a residual estimate of about $2 million in the B-Part fund balance. How it does it, provides the funding for the Central Reach Project is by increasing the tax rate by 7 cents, increases inspections fees and water and sewer fees. It also establishes dock fees to go along with the stand-up of the boating infrastructure grant dock out here at the Rothschild Davis Park. It reconditions and paves streets in accordance with the streets plan, and those two streets this year are Tide Ridge Drive and Jordan Boulevard. I believe it's about $120,000. This year's budget retains current employee benefits. It finishes the park with the through the contractual arrangement with North Carolina for the part of project. It increases the solid waste budgets in response to some of the expenses that we've incurred this year, although I want to point out that that contract with Waste Industries is up for review in January, and we will be looking at the different services that we offer the town citizens there, so that is subject to some modification in terms of service level in solid waste. The budget funds the gen sets from the central, from the capital plan. In tonight's agenda, there's a presentation from the Sewer Advisory Committee that makes some recommendations for waterproofing, floodproofing our lift stations. What we've done, we've gone in and pulled out the procurement of the two generator sets and the hookups for all four lift stations to have standby power on all of those. And the current, this year's projected budget continues with the canal dredging program. What it doesn't do, it doesn't provide any cost of living adjustments or merit raises for the employees. There are no Lockwood Folly Inlet Navigation maintenance dollars, i.e. either for the inlet proper, the throat of the inlet with a side caster dredge, which is the merit, nor does it provide any funding for any shallow draft inlet 5 maintenance to put least cost method of disposal sand on the beach should the Corps have the Merton available for us. There's no Lockwood Folly Inlet crossing money budgeted this year for any piggyback work that may become available should the opportunity to arise. And that opportunity has presented itself with the Corps supposed to be here in November. So with a residual of fund balance in the B-Part fund, this budget doesn't make a recommendation to fund it. That's a decision that the board can make later on once we know how many yards are projected, what types of impact to our permit, and what the state's burden share could be. There is no engineering for sewer lift station fixes in this proposed budget. There will be a presentation later on that talks about lift station fixes. We have not appropriated that or made the recommendation to appropriate money for those lift station fixes since we don't know how that's going to shake out. That can always be made as a fund balance appropriation from your existing water and sewer funds. The capital improvement plan, it's like I said before, it's a 10-year effort to scope what all of the different requirements coming towards the town over the next 10 years are going to be. In total, it represents about almost $24 million. In the general fund, that is primarily streets money for the street survey. It's a little over $1 million there. For the water and sewer funds, about $2.5 million. Various equipment, primarily $2.2 million there, are the lift station improvements or upgrades that will be coming to you as a recommendation, and also the water tower rehab. That's about a $250,000 rehab. The water tower hadn't been painted in, 30 years, Chris? 25 years?
Complete strip down.
It's a complete strip down and repaint. Canal dredging project totals about $2.2 million over the course of 10 years. And the lion's share of the entire capital budget is, of course, the Central Reach Beach project at $15 million. Okay, those are my slides for the kickoff for the public.
All right. This is a public hearing. Mr. Hughes, you might want to stay up there in case we have any questions.
I'm going to get some water.
All right. Anyone have any questions? This is an opportunity for the public to talk. The commissioners and so forth will talk in the regular meeting, unless you want to do something different. Okay. Any comments from or questions from the audience?
Yes, sir.
Well, which canal are you talking about?
It's all of the canals.
Oh, okay.
That's the all three of the subdivisions. And that's a collective number, if you will, all of them, even though they are segregated by canal subdivisions.
But make the point that we pay for that, the town doesn't pay for that. Thank you.
The subdivision property owners pay for that. That is not either a tax base nor an occupancy tax funded effort.
And none of them to be dredged this year.
None of them to be dredged this year. I believe if you look at that capital plan, it's in year 3 and year 8, this year being the first year. And that, of course, could vacillate depending on what the conditions of the canals would be. The way that process works is that Harbor Acres and Holden Beach Harbor and Heritage Harbor are on roughly the same schedule. Harbor Acres is in an off schedule. So what happens when Harbor Acres has their entrance canal dredged, Heritage Harbor and Holden Beach Harbor get a full dredge, and vice versa. Harbor Acres had the last full dredge. So the upcoming dredge in year 3 should be Heritage Harbor and Holden Beach Harbor getting full dredge, and Harbor Acres just getting a clean out.
Mr. Wood?
What will be a collection this year?
Yes, and that's in the budget ordinance. It's about $250, $325, and $375. I forget exactly which one it is.
Mr. Wood, do you want to speak?
No Lockwood Folly dredging with the Merritt or the Merton. Is that because it's more important to do other things this year, or is the state shallow inlet, shallow draft inlet program going to pick that up a few times?
Let me answer that two ways. It's kind of, to begin with, it's kind of hard to program what your contribution to the matching funds for the Corps' effort will be, because there aren't any federal dollars for the inlet throat proper, and they show up as they show up. As a matter of fact, there's an item on the agenda tonight to actually fund, reprogram some dollars for Lockwood Folly Inlet to help the county pay for the Memorial Day dredge. The second piece of that is the core schedule in the waterway crossing is every other year. We don't know what those quantities may be. So there is no appropriation in the budget. That's not to say whenever it happens that there can't be an appropriation made. Just did not make an appropriation this year. Didn't know what to make.
Anyone else? Yes, sir.
Yeah, I just wanted to ask a question about the central reach. I'm sorry I was late to the meeting, but I just came to another meeting and that. But that $15 million, is that spread out over this bond period of time, over the 10-year period of time? Question number one.
$15 million is broken down as roughly a half a million dollars of that. It's a $15 million project. Half a million dollars of that will be funded through FEMA, a previous storm damage project that we had. $3 million will be pay-go cash funded from the BPART fund. And then the residual, a little less than $11.5 million would be bond funded and paid back over 10 years. That's what the plan is.
Okay.
All right.
I guess, you know, being a concerned resident, I'm at 169 Brunswick Avenue East. My name is Joe Butler. And one of the concerns I have is, as the mayor so kindly in the last meeting, and you really impressed me with 35 million, 15 million, 7.5 million, you know, the numbers stuck in my head. And I went back and did a little math, and then I took a look at some of the reports that you sent out too as well. And I got to say, I'm concerned going forward. I'm really concerned that we're not biting off more than we can chew at this time. That's, you know, I just wanted to make that blanket statement. And I'm not picking on anybody or anything like that, but I'm just concerned.
Anyone else? Thank you, ma'am. Mr. Wood?
But for the beach strand, this town will go broke. If you don't have an adequate beach strand, the taxpayers who live here year-round will see their taxes go up dramatically because this beach is subsidized by renters from Ohio and places like that. I've got two beach houses on the east end, not part of Central Reach. Those houses generate more than twice as much tax revenue to the town than the real estate tax does on those properties. So the rental houses are subsidizing the beach house, the year-round residents here. And if your beach strand is not adequate for the locals or the tourists to enjoy, it's just another subdivision near the water. And it won't. The value of your property won't be as good as it is now, and the rentals and the revenue that's generated by the rentals will not be here to subsidize. So I support it, even though my section of the beach is not going to benefit a bit by it.
Yes, sir.
Let me just clarify my statement that renourishment of the beaches is a top priority. I have no problem with that, and that's not my point.
Okay.
I think it did such a great job when we laid the pipes across the beach and from the inlet coming east to about 162 Brunswick Ocean Boulevard. That was a great project. I never saw so much sand in my life. That was really good.
Thank you.
So I'm in favor of it.
All right. Anyone else? All right. We're going to close this public hearing. Thank you, Mr. Hewitt. Public hearing is declared closed. We'll now move along to our regular monthly meeting. Those of you that may not have the paperwork to go along with this meeting, the agenda and so forth is on the table in the back of the room. And let's begin our regular meeting with a moment of silence and reflection and keeping in mind all those that have suffered greatly in unusual ways in the recent couple of weeks that we're all aware of. So just take a moment. Thank you. Thank you very much, and we'll officially call the meeting to order. Welcome all of you for an exciting night here in dealing with the budget and some other interesting items. I'm sure you're going to find it's better than TV. And let's all stand and pledge our allegiance to the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I just realized on my document here, we need to approve the agenda somewhere or other. I guess that's the next thing. And in considering the agenda, we note that we have already had the pleasure of listening to Marie Pierre Fletcher sing, so I guess we would be in order to have an amendment to the agenda since we've already done that and ask that maybe there's a consideration of approving the amended agenda.
I so move.
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. All right, let's go to number six, the approval of minutes. Is there a motion to approve the special minutes, the minutes of the special meeting of May 17th?
So move.
Motion is second.
Second.
Discussion, hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. It's unanimous. And number 6B, the minutes of the regular meeting of May 17th. Is there a motion to approve those?
So moved.
Motion and a second.
Second.
Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. They stand unanimously approved. Number 7, public comments on agenda items. I have a list here, and we'll go down the list as the order being that was people signed up. And Mr. Lynn Holden, 110 Mullet Street, you have the floor, sir, if you will come to the podium to speak in the microphone.
I'll yield my time to the next person right now, please.
Mr. Will Carter, 108 Starfish.
Will Carter, 108 Starfish. I'm here tonight. I started coming here in 1965. Bought a house in 1970. I moved here full time. Been a voter since 2003. Came here to talk about the terminal growing tonight. And after 50 years on Holden Beach, I hate to see a lot of progress. And I've seen a lot of progress. And with that progress, there's always been deniers. We started out, we had canal deniers, town and corporation deniers, water, bridge, sidewalk, paving, sewer, boat ramp, and my favorite playground deniers. And back then they told me that we don't have any kids on the island that would use a playground. I think that's been proven wrong. This time, at one time I was even a town hall denier. I didn't think this town hall ought to be built because it was too expensive. Now we've got growing deniers. And I have read the reports, and the opposition raises mainly a great objections, but on further examination, I find that most of the academia which are against the project are also against building on barrier islands. And they suggest we be more like fiddler crabs and kind of move our houses around with the sands of the beaches. And these people obviously have not been here and seen it for as long as a lot of people have. We're the only island that exists around here that is east-west. The other islands are north and south. They talk about the longshore transport a whole lot all your reports and all these academia. But our problem is from the intercoastal waterway. The Corps of Engineers started this problem when they dug out the Yellow Banks and they dug out the backside. We've got a high volume of water that comes in and out every single time the tide comes in and out twice a day. And this water that comes in and out through our inlet would be better served having a growing facility there, which instead of making the water go wide, would make the water go deep. And I believe believe, if I could get David Hewitt to tell me, what did you say about the Bald Head Island growing that's in?
I just saw a real good picture of how it works from an aerial perspective. It appears to be working well.
And you say there was so much sand that it was going over the top of the groin and overfilling.
It's filled up and it's actually spilling across.
And the benefits of the groin are many for wildlife, homeowners, boaters, fishermen, and the drawbacks are mainly monetary. And this is the denier's main concern on this. And I, as many others that have been here most of our lives, have seen what's going on at the inlet, as have the residents of Ocean Isle, Bald Head, Figure Eight, and all the other inlet towns that have already recognized the positive effect and have purchased their pieces of rock and for future protection. This project will be done someday, but the window is open now to proceed. The deniers will achieve the same result as the Sunset Bridge deniers, which summed up the up to inconvenience and exponential cost, which will be passed on to their grandchildren and taxpayers forever. I would like to ask this board to please approve this long-awaited opportunity while it is available, not try to leave an avenue for an open door to keep this project on time. To get this done, as all our neighbors have seized the opportunity, paying more will not be to the taxpayers' benefit. And it will be done. The park, I started in 2003 on that. We finally got new basketball goals all around here. That was only 13 years. And it went. And there was a lot of people that didn't want it. And some of those people have passed away now. But this groin is something we need. It's something that every other beach has. It's something that every other inlet that's around here that's usable needs to have. The other day, a 50-foot boat came in here in the inlet. It hit ground. 15 people fell down to the ground, according to the fireman. And somebody's going to get hurt. We have these people come down here to go fishing. They go boating. They ride jet skis. They do all types of things. And as soon as a kid gets out here in an inlet, that the buoys don't match the ditch. The buoys do not match the ditch. So when a few kids get hurt, then maybe we'll see it. But this will be built, and it might not be with this board, but it will be built.
Thank you, Mr. Carter. Tony Morowitz. 118 Frigate Street.
I was on the sewer vulnerability committee, and I unfortunately had to miss the last two meetings, so I don't know exactly what Mike's going to present to you tonight. But there is one thing that I think needs to be addressed. If you can wave your magic wand and do all of the things that are in the sewer vulnerability suggestion list, we still have a problem. To the best of my knowledge, if we have a problem in a lift station, you got 3.5 hours to get it fixed. Or you start putting sewer up in the ground on the floor of the lift stations, or you evacuate part of the island. I think that needs to be fixed. You need to find a way to bypass a lift station. It's not going to be easy. I know Chris has tried it before. I talked to Leo Green, who's the engineer that was on the committee, did a heck of a job. I foresee a monster pump on a trailer that you pull up and bypass the thing. It's going to take a huge pump, but I think it needs to be addressed. You need to address it with air vac. We, the town, needs to address it with air vac. And I think Ocean Isle and Sunset Beach, who is, I think, now Brunswick County, have exactly the same problem. If those lift stations go down, they got probably 3.5 hours too. Mm-hmm. So I think a joint venture to try and find a bypass solution would be an excellent thing to look into. And if you had it in the report, I apologize for stepping on your feet. But thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Morowitz. Mr. Irvin Woods, 259 Ocean Boulevard East.
Good
Good evening. I'm Irvin Woods. My wife and I own property at 259 Ocean Boulevard East and 289 Ocean Boulevard East. I'm here to discuss the parking ordinance, and maybe Rhonda can correct me if I have a misunderstanding. Looking at the draft ordinance on page 2 of the draft ordinance, under the section identified McCray Street, item number 4. Rhonda, can you tell me if what's referred to as Ocean Boulevard East Extension is what most of us know as Ocean Boulevard East between Avenue A and Dunescape? The little isolated section of Ocean Boulevard? I've never known it as Ocean Boulevard East Extension. Mr. Mayor?
My recollection is that whenever it went straight from the west end of the curve, beginning there at the beginning of the curve, as you go that way.
Okay. I'm just trying to figure before I address the issue. Are this section, item number 4, is that between Abbott, the section of Ocean Boulevard along the beach? If it is.
Yeah. I can't tell you why it's called.
Well, I mean, the reason I asked Rhonda is because it came, I mean, the staff part came from her. If item number 4 is a 2-block isolated section of Ocean Boulevard East from Avenue A, Avenue B, to Dunescape Avenue.
If I could interject.
Sure.
The item on the agenda only addresses Ranger Street. That's the only thing on the agenda pertinent to
this
tonight.
This ordinance doesn't address
the change. The proposed change is for Ranger Street.
Okay. Only. Well, while we've got the ordinance in front of us, if this is in fact the current ordinance, next time you look at it, you need to take a review of it. Ocean Boulevard East Extension, which we believe is Ocean Boulevard, no parking on the south side of the street from Avenue A to Dunescape Drive. Well, that makes sense because the dune comes right down to the edge of the street. But it appears that parking is available on the north side of the street. The problem is we have a 2-block section there with sidewalks, and I walked out, parked my car on the edge of the road this afternoon, and there is just enough room for a vehicle to pass if people legally park and don't park on the sidewalk. So either people are going to be parking on the sidewalk, and apparently they can legally do it now, either park in the street or they're going to be parking on the sidewalk. I would suggest the next time you review this section is that no parking allowed in that 2-block section because, one, there's very little room for vehicles to pass if someone legally parks not on the sidewalk, or either otherwise they're going to be parking on the sidewalk.
Thank you. Mr. Holden, Lynn Holden, where did he go?
He's still there.
He's still there.
You got the floor, sir.
I gave up my time.
Oh, you gave it up. I thought you just wanted to pass over you. Okay. That takes care of those that have signed up for the commentary here, and we are now going to go to number 8, the budget report, Town Manager Mr. Hewitt.
This is the summary report of the budget year that we're currently in as of 1 June. And provides a rack up or a status of where we are as of that date. A little bit about this chart. This is a macro scale chart. There are 6 columns in the chart, and it is segregated by fund into revenue and expenses and the difference between the two. First column is the fund, general fund, water and sewer fund, B part fund, and the canal dredging fund. The next column is the budget, actual expenses, year-to-date. The fourth column is the encumbrances, and that by that I mean those are contracts or outstanding purchases that the bills haven't been paid on but were obligated for. And then the delta is the difference between the columns from left to right. So what this means in the far right-hand column is that as of 1 June this year, even though that's a negative $146,000, that's how far we are ahead in terms of actual revenues, less actual expenses and encumbrances. In the water and sewer fund, likewise, we're $383,000 ahead in actual revenues, less expenses and encumbrances. And then for the BPARC fund, we're actually about close to $4,000 behind. And in the canal dredging fund, we are almost $1.4 million to the good in the canal dredging fund. Now, the BPARC fund itself, this is not an alarm slide, but if you don't know how to read it, it may alarm you. Because and you say, oh, we're $140,000 ahead in the general fund. We must be doing good. We are, but you got to keep in mind that our cash burn rate in the general fund is in excess of $217,000 a month. So I don't know if we're doing good or not. Over in the water fund, likewise, our cash burn rate is close to $300,000 a month. And in the BPARC fund, much of that difference there is tied up with encumbrances to the tune of about $400,000, and those are represented by fund balance appropriations, which are accounting entries that basically take the money from our fund balance and move it into the operations fund.
Mr. Hewitt.
David, what is this effective to date or projected end of month?
That's 1 June, as of 1 June.
As of 1 June.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Hewitt, the encumbrances, the contracts and outstanding purchases, are those year to date or projected through the end of year?
That's one as of 1 June. Everything's 1 June.
Okay. All right. And the is it fair to surmise that the water and sewer category, given that we've had significant repairs already year to date, that we are in pretty good shape if we wanted to prorate the repairs that we've done so far and then against the rest of the year balance of what
no,
we know about?
No, not at all. In the challenge in this budget is multiplied or magnified by the fact that specifically water, sewer, and really all of our funds, we take a whole lot of money in the middle of the year in taxes. And then our expenditures in the middle of the year, we don't have that many. So the expenditures and the revenue collections in all of these funds are cyclical, and they offset each other. They're like two sine waves that go the opposite. We take a lot of money in, we don't spend it until it feasts or famine. So this $300,000 saved, well, we're way ahead. But Chris just tells me the other day that we spent on Memorial Day, we approached about 900,000 gallons a day of water consumption on the Memorial Day weekend. So those bills for the water haven't come in yet. And so is that making sense? So our challenge is always one of cash flow in addition to the budget. Because okay. We take a lot of money in 1 month, and then we get hit with a famine the next month.
Okay. I guess what I would say then is that it would be helpful to have a projection line on here as well for the remainder of the year. Because
that's beyond my ability to do. I would not dare try to make that type of projection.
Well, I'll finish my statement. This is a good snapshot of where we are, but from my experience with budgeting, short, if you don't have a projection that you can look at, which is a projection, it's not a statement of fact, it's hard to, that's why I asked my question about what we spent so far on water and sewer. I'd like to know what do we expect to spend within the best judgment we can apply. What do we expect to spend the rest of the year? Because we're going to be looking likely at moving funds in the event we do have some unforeseen expenditures. So that's where those projections can come in.
Are you speaking of fiscal year or calendar year?
Fiscal year.
So we've got 10 days left.
But do you mean in the future?
I mean, yeah. I mean, what month to month or however, whenever we're going to get a report like this, I would like to see what we project against the budget. Because rarely does a budget have, do you spend what you've budgeted exactly? I mean, that's just not realistic.
If I understand what you're saying, it would be a percentage?
Correct.
And every month, say on this, at the end of the 6 month, looking toward the end of the year, if you spent half of your money that you've budgeted, then you know where you are, right?
Yeah.
That's what you're talking about.
Or if you spent less on one category, then we could consider, okay, then that could be a buffer applied elsewhere.
And, of course, the problem is, like Mr. Hewitt was saying, it's like this, but overall you can see.
Yeah.
Okay. Anything else? You got anything else? Did one of you guys have something to say?
Nope.
Ma'am, you're mighty quiet on your end of the thing tonight.
I'm good so far.
Mr. Hewitt, you got anything else on this line item?
Nope, that's it.
Mr. Hewitt, when do you want us to consider action on this?
It's just a report back to the board as a result of your request from the budget workshops on what you desired to see in the upcoming months from time to time.
But what I'm asking you is you have to have the budget approved by the 30th, right?
Yeah, this is the snapshot of this year, but the budget consideration item that's later. Down later
yes.
in the
okay.
agenda.
Is you want that done tonight, though, right?
It's on the agenda for y'all's
okay.
consideration.
All right, just making sure everybody understands we are going to address it tonight. All right. Police report, Chief Wally Lane.
Good evening, everyone. So far, it's been a typical busy season, but no major incidents. I think the flashing sign on the causeway has been a huge help. And the reason I say that is, after riding the beach since Memorial Day, I've encountered one dog, and that belonged to a property owner. But they were very nice, it was on a leash, and they removed it from the beach when we spoke to them. I don't think Chris has got a tractor trailer load of cabanas or anything like that so far. I think maybe a week since we started.
And average about maybe one a day, some days none, but nothing massive. It's really surprising to me.
When do y'all pick those up, Chris? In the morning or in the evening?
Well, I've been running in the morning. The ice is good myself, and I usually go out on 6 o'clock, and I make a run through there because that wind was from, 7 to 8.
Yep.
I think you're right, Chris.
And we intend to leave the flashing sign up all summer?
I do. Unless somebody has a problem with
it. Chief, I have to tell you, since it went up, and I'm right on the beach, and every morning I can go out and look, every night I can look. Before that, there was always some tents or something out there, and not once. Every morning I go out at 5:30 in the morning, the beach is clear. I go out at 6:30, at 7 o'clock at night, they're clear. So somebody's reading that and getting the message.
I don't know how you could miss it. I mean, I've kind of clocked it myself. You can see the whole thing at least four times as you're coming down the causeway. All three items, at least four times. Now, what's going to be the real test is that all fireworks are illegal. Because we're coming up on the 4th of July. That'll be really interesting to see how many folk pay attention to that during the actual 2 weeks of the 4th. Because before the 4th, they'll celebrate Friday night. And then they'll celebrate on the 4th. And probably all that rest of that week. So the fun times are ahead. That's what I was getting at, too. We're just gearing up for the 4th of July and the rest of hurricane season. Already two little tropical blips. It's still early. Everybody keep that in mind. Have your plan. Be glad to answer any questions.
Chief, I have a question for you, and it's because of one of the commissioner's experiences here. When I call 911 and report an incident, how does the officer find out about that?
He's dispatched by radio.
By radio, which can be monitored?
Yes.
I see.
Dispatched by radio.
Because one of the commissioners called in a noise complaint, and about 5 minutes later, the noise disappeared, long before the officer got there. A former commissioner and a current commissioner, not me.
Yeah.
So somebody's monitoring.
Scanners exist. Scanners are out there. And realistically, though, they just updated the radios again, and those transmissions are supposed to be scrambled. So unless they continuously modify their scanners, I don't know how that's possible. But
okay.
Yes, ma'am. You know, we could say that. Well, at this point, the no is working pretty good.
I know, but no, I've gotten a lot of negative from a lot of homeowners on the beach that it's all saying no, that the tourists coming are looking at it like they don't want to see it. It would be nice to have welcome.
I don't have a problem with it. I mean, what we're trying to do is educate folks so that instead of getting a ticket, they see it when they're coming on the beach, they know what the deal is, and then they just do the right thing. And then we don't have to give them a ticket. I mean, those are the options. We could put welcome to Holden Beach and take the rest of it off and then write them tickets all day. I mean, that's the option.
Go ahead, ma'am.
We got the banner at the bottom of the bridge.
True that.
I just wondered how much one of the signs cost.
That trailer?
Yeah.
That's about
20?
Yeah, about 20 grand. Okay. Not cheap, but very effective.
But what you're saying is you've got all these no. Could we, on that same sign, start with welcome to Holden Beach? No fireworks. You know, just have that as one little blip.
We absolutely could.
For programming purposes.
We absolutely could. Okay. We can put whatever we want to just about on that sign.
Or the welcome sign really is on this side of the beach, and now the landscape, the other, if they could do a canvas, you know, one like is at the foot of the bridge on the other side.
that might take care of it too. But we can't, I mean, the sign is programmable. We can adjust as we need to. Whatever you folks want to do, my folks will comply. You give me the word and we'll take care of it.
All right, thank you, Chief. Mr. Mike Sullivan is going to give us a sanitary sewer vulnerability report.
Good evening. Give a little recap. The vulnerability committee was formed by ordinance or by request of the Board of Commissioners, and that request asked the Vulnerability Committee to determine the system vulnerability to flooding and storm surge, B, flood levels that may impact the system, C, types of potential failures and time and cost to repair them, D, the availability of replacement parts, E, review other similar systems in coastal North Carolina communities, and F, present our recommendations. Go down these one by one. The first thing was that our mandate was limited to finding out the vulnerabilities for flooding and storm surge. And we came back to the board and asked them to expand that because the committee determined that there were other instances and other events that could cause damage to the system, such as lightning strikes, automobile accidents, et cetera, et cetera. So the board gave us that permission and at the same time asked us to list in priority order what we thought the vulnerabilities were. So we've done that. We made a chart listing the vulnerabilities. After a lot of discussion, the committee decided that the manner in which the system is the most vulnerable would be through electrical outage, because it could happen by an automobile accident, it could be something that happened on the island, it could be something that happened off the island that would feed electricity to the island. There were just more ways for that to happen than by storm surge or flooding. So we listed the electricity first, storm surge second, and from talking to Chris Clemens and Eric Long in the department, the breakdown of the retention tank, which is kept in a subterranean vault at each one of the lift stations. There's a chance that when they were put in there, the understanding was that they would last forever, but it seems that they're deteriorating and that at some point they're going to have to be replaced. So that's the third most important vulnerability. Other ones going down in descending order, that the pumps fail to work, that there's an electrical outlet because one of the component parts in the electrical panels, which each one of those breakdowns can be fixed by the Public Works Department, and they've done it time and time again by replacing pumps, electrical parts, and so on. So most of the report zeroes in on the three main vulnerabilities. We were also asked by the Board of Commissioners to see if there was some way we could get component parts, we could get into a sharing type of group where instead of having to have an inventory of all the various parts that keep the system working, we could get in partnership with the other coastal communities. But there are a number of issues with that particular avenue. One is you'd have to enter some sort of legal understanding. Two, was pointed out to us by David Hewitt, that if there is a time when there's a flood, nobody who's in the position to loan you any component parts is going to be too willing to do that. They're going to be looking out, and rightfully so, looking out for the people who live on their island. So that makes it tough. And there's a third one, that each one of our lift stations is unique in one way or another, so that we can't even use component parts from lift station 2 to repair lift station 3. So because of the uniqueness of our system, the hesitation by people to share, the legal complications, we really didn't give much credence to being able to get into a sharing type of relationship. The availability of replacement parts, we've included on the chart that we gave to the commissioners and gave to the, it's on the website, the town website, and you can look at it. We have, excuse me a second. Cost to replace an electrical panel is $45,000 and change. It'd take about 3 months to do that. We don't have any of those on inventory. Cost to replace some pumps are $39,000 a piece. We have two of those. And as I said before, Public Works is very adept at making these types of changes if it breaks down. Sewage holding tank, which I mentioned earlier, it's $80,000 item. We don't have any of those on hand. The vacuum pumps, $50,000. We have two of those on hand. They're $25,000 a piece, so we have $50,000 in inventory. The submersible pumps, which actually take the sewage and put it into the system, we have three of those. They're roughly $20,000 a piece, $21,000. And we have other component parts. If you look at it, we have a couple $100,000 worth of inventory on hand. All the inventory will be about $700,000. It's quite a bit of money. The part about the flood levels that may impact the system, we requested help from FEMA and NOAA and other groups. Nobody is able to give us an approximation with any type of specificity on what the likelihood is of a storm actually hitting a particular island in any period of time. All they fall back on is that you have the 100-year flood level, which is what we use for the flood zone, and depending on where you live, it's so many, it's X feet. What we did do, though, was a little research, and NOAA publishes the frequency of hurricanes up and down the East Coast. And it also gives you a look at what storm surge would result from a Category 3 or Category 2 or Category 4 storm. And you can see that with Category 3 or Category 4 storm, our system would be overflow. Storm surge would go there, so we have to try to protect that. So to get to the crux of the issue here is the way our system is currently built, we have concrete vault that's below ground. And it has our pumps in it, and it has our electrical equipment in it. And you see, there's a small building that's on top of this slab of concrete. The concrete's 2 feet thick. The retention tank is underneath that. The electricity is underneath that. And the pumps are underneath that. If we were to have a flood, clearly the electricity would be locked out, knocked out. And as Tony had said earlier, depending on the season, you could go during the winter time when there's only 700 of us on the island, the system can go, you know, if one of these things happens, a little bit longer than it could on the 4th of July weekend when we have 10,000 or 20,000 people on the island. So all of the other islands, when they had their system built it so that the pumps and the electrical portions were above the 100-year flood level. And that's what we're suggesting we do here, that we take the underground vault, remove the electrical equipment from it, remove, there are some pumps that are submersible, so they will operate even if there is a flood, but take the pumps that are susceptible to being damaged with the flood and put it above the flood level at each one of the flood stations. And what we would suggest is, because pump station number one is actually just at flood level, obviously it has the least amount of potential damage to it, it's the least vulnerable. And so we would suggest that if the the board decides to follow the suggestion to work on pump two first and take the component parts that are in pump two, what really happens is we have to build another station that's totally operable and kind of flip the switch. So we go from the current station that's at two to the new station that's at two. Now what we suggest is we take all the component parts out of two, because we're putting all the ones in there to build it, and take whatever component parts we have in two and then go work on number three or number four and use whatever parts we can. But as Tim Evans pointed out, those parts have been there for a while. We all know what happens living by the beach, things corrode, and so he'll have to have that all inspected to see what can be reused and what can't be. But our hope is that we'll be able to take a good part of the component parts due to the electrical, save that, reuse it as we go down the line. And just to address what Tony brought up, spoke to Chris about the ability to kind of bypass the retention tanks, and the company that put in the system says the only way you can do it is to unhook some pipes, tap in with more pipes, and then bring a portable truck there to use it as a drain. Currently, it does not work. It's there, it's an idea, but it doesn't work on your own. It's been tried.
That's great.
Yeah. So we can keep looking for other methods to bypass it, but at this point, nobody is aware of any way to do it right now. Go back, I left one thing out. One of the problems, and the big problem that we have, the retention tanks, as I said, is subterranean, 8-10 feet underground, 2 feet of concrete. If those tanks were to burst, not be operable, you'd have to break through the concrete. You could break up the old tank and get it out, but you couldn't get a new tank because there's nothing but a stairwell to go down to the subterranean. So you have to break up the 2 feet of concrete, take the old tank out, put a new tank in. So part of the suggestion that we have, in addition to putting the component parts that can be damaged by the water underground, take them from underground and put them above ground, above the flood level, is to cut a hole in the existing cement, which is actually the roof of the lift station. Cut a hole in that, support the cement that still remains, and put in a hatch so that if the day does come, and it seems that it's inevitable that it will, that you can just open up the hatch, take the old tank out, and put the new tank in. If you don't do it that way, it'll take weeks, if not months, to replace it. So the recommendations here are costly. It runs to about $2.2 million. But it is a way to, once and for all, take the vulnerabilities out of the flooding, out of the storm. As David pointed out, the electricity, we currently have two electrical generators. We need four. This year's budget has allocated money to do that, and the electrical parts that have to be modified in order to take care of that. And one of the other things, as we went through this, it was like pulling on a thread on a sweater. Every time you looked at something, there was just a little bit more to go at. Talking to Tim Evans, once we start this work, we have to bring everything up to code. And right now, OSHA violations exist with the men in the Public Works Department working below ground in places that have no ventilation, that in the summer go over 100 degrees, and there are a lot of other issues. So we have to build these things. Once we start working on it, we have to bring it all up to code. So that was another issue that the committee looked at and decided we'll put it all out there. This is the best way that we know available at this time to protect the interest of everybody that lives on the island. Thank you.
Mr. Salk, question for you. With regard to the retention tanks, I find it shocking that someone would state that a tank will last forever, but be that as it may, do we do any non-destructive testing on the tanks? I mean, that's a common practice with any metal tank. And what do those show in terms of what do they show in terms of wall thinning, corrosion, or just degradation due to flow?
Well, we actually have to clean those tanks once a year. It's carbon fiber steel tank, and it has like a rubber membrane coating on the inside of it, sort of about the equivalent to a bed liner on a pickup truck. And we have noticed the past few years we have some places where that liner's actually flaking off of it, and we're starting to see some corrosion as far as telling what thickness is there. I actually don't have any proof to back that up, but sure, you're probably aware hydrogen plus sulfide gas is just as corrosive as solid air, and you know, it's definitely going to happen one day. I don't know what year that'll be, but we're going to try to monitor the best of our ability on a yearly basis on cleaning to try to predict, you know, something before it happens. And while he was talking about sort of sidestepping, there's no way of running that system without having a collection tank. It's not a matter of just backing up or hooking a pump up on top of the ground and pulling the vacuum and you run your system. You have to have a collection tank. These pictures right here, I've got some more of them, but you can see the massive, this don't really do it justice, the massive plumbing and stuff that you'd have to put up above ground, and it would probably take you days to do this versus if you already had that hatch in place and the right tank, you can change it up quicker, you can plumb the station up like this. But the ideal world, that collection tank should be treated just like the regular sewage pump. If we take those electrical components out and move them up top, I think we should have a second collection tank sitting there also, that when you've had tank troubles, you could just switch over to that tank while you were repairing the other one. But that's just the way I see it in a perfect world.
So just so I understand, back to the non-destructive testing, you clean once a year, you've noticed that there's some degradation in the rubber membrane, and you've noticed corrosion, some corrosion.
Yeah.
So we aren't monitoring the wall thickness of the tanks, the metal that's actually...
Well, if I take a hammer and hit it and I see a chunk of rust fall out of it a quarter inch thick, I know it's actually getting thinner, but no, I'm not trying to be smart. I haven't really had any kind of analysis.
Well, the reason I'm asking, I think we should look into it because it's that kind of a measurement that gives us an estimate of tank failure. And also it could help us prioritize because, you know, we got to look at a way of somehow, that's why we focused on prioritizing and also looking at risk and, you know, risk and consequence. And in this case, this could afford us, I mean, the testing can be done and it's not exorbitant costs, but it would give us some physical basis for deferring some tank replacements if we need to. My second comment is, I understand there are engineers, and this is no reflection on the committee. You've done a lot of research here, a lot of good data for us to look at. We're in a much better position now to look at the physical state of our sewer system. So I want to commend the committee before I say what I'm about to say, because it has nothing to do with the committee. But engineers, I understand, were involved in the original design. And I'm not an engineer by trade, but I was appalled when we went to look at these stations just by the design itself. I mean, electrical connections subground just don't make sense in anybody's world. So given that, I think it would be reasonable for us to get an independent engineering assessment of these recommendations to ensure that we have, you know, you don't know what you don't know. So I would offer that as a consideration.
I have no problem with that, but I just would point out that the person who did the drawings, the person who made the suggestions of it, is an engineer.
I understand. I read that.
Okay. He's an engineer.
But typically, this would be a design change, if you will. And in my previous world, any design change had an independent engineering assessment. for the magnitude of what we're looking at here, both in terms of risk and expense, I would think that should be considered.
I agree. I mean, these buildings are a rendering of a suggestion of what you could do to protect it. It wasn't meant to be the last and final word on what. It's just the committee saying, here, this is the idea. Take a look at it.
Okay, just so you understand, I'm...
I got you.
I would like to see an independent engineering assessment of the committee's work. That way, they aren't approaching it from the standpoint of the filter of, this is the recommendation, what do you think? You know, just... Okay.
Mike, if I'm correct, the person that designed this and put it in the ground was an engineer?
No doubt.
On the board, I think.
No doubt about it.
No, he didn't design it.
He didn't design it?
No.
Just recommended it?
It was URS was the company that did the, was the design engineer. And firm.
But you guys did a great job looking at all the risk.
Thank you. Yep.
I agree. I think I went to every meeting, and there was a lot of effort, many hours. But I would also concur that second opinion makes sense. Do our due diligence. I have a question, though, Chris. If you find, when you're looking at the tanks and there's flaking, do we repair that?
No, sir.
Okay.
Don't know how you would from the inside. You know, it's got limited time. You have to get back on the line. You know, like you're saying, time limit to be able to get that tank plugged back up. Get vacuum on the system there. It really depends on what time of year. You know, you have not had to hold and shut it off for 6 or 8 hours and have somebody come here and make that type of repair.
Chris, if you shut one down, what effect does it have on the other three stations?
It don't have anything on the other three. Well, let me backtrack that. I'll use this west or the east end, for example. Everything from High Point Street to Dunham's Gate actually works through the pump station. It goes through pump station one, goes through the collection tank. The only thing at this site that would affect pump station two would be the wet well, which is independent of the collection tank, so that's besides the point. So everything High Point to the east end would be affected as far as having vacuum at your house and your toilet flushing like it should. But with a vacuum system, you don't have that kind of holding capacity to spend 6 or 8 hours, you know, hunting a source. It's a scramble just to shut one of those down and try to clean those things on a yearly basis. You know, I guess it probably must be in the beach environment. I know everybody knows when you get home on the beach and you go in and you wash your hair, your sand and everything comes out of your hair. It's about like a sandblaster going through those tanks. Suddenly there's more sand in than there is anything else in a year's time. That was just one of the things, you know, we were looking at vulnerability, you know, but we'd seen those things on that tank, and you know, I just come to me, you know, something one day this is gonna have to be changed. And if this concrete, we don't have access hatch, that's gonna be a lengthy process, and you know, we just got the means of
I agree, but I think it would behoove us to get an expert to look at these tanks. It was supposed to be, you know, a lifetime guarantee, whatever that meant.
I did design this system, but there is a stainless steel tank. If you're talking lifetime cars, then when you get stainless steel, you might be saying you got something lifetime.
Yep.
And anybody carbon fiber ain't gonna be it.
Because if you look at the numbers, it's over $700,000 just to accommodate the changing of the tank. So it's a significant amount of money to change the tank out, and we don't. I'm not convinced we're 100% understanding of the lifetime of the tank. So maybe they truly are going to last 40 plus years.
Well, even if you put 40 years on it, we done burnt 10 of it up. So
yep.
We got 30 left.
My other question is the new generators and the two existing, are they going to be on, and I know they're going to be wired up, are they going to be on ground level?
Yeah. But what we would do in that situation, if we were in, if, you know, we seen the potential, you know, of a flood coming, we could actually pull the generators off and carry them off the island with us. Keep them safe, bring them back after the come. We we're in a storm situation, and I know it's different for a high storm, but if we're in a storm situation and we were facing the possibility of flood, it's also a permit requirement to shut the station down anyway, so it would be a lot if it's cold and it's inconvenient. I'd rather be where you could care more.
Okay.
It'd be trailerized.
Yeah. Okay.
I had one other comment. I apologize for going back, but it's a safety issue. That's the first thing I saw also was a confined space, which is has specific requirements for monitoring the atmosphere before you go in, and also monitoring the temperature and the stay time you're going to be in there. So what are we doing to mitigate what is currently, oh, and it requires posting, as you're probably aware. Where do we stand on all those?
It takes two people in a confined space. You've got to have an attendant there.
Right. And they have to be trained.
You've got to be taking atmospheric conditions. I mean, so, you know, we want all this, you know, 24-hour seven service. You know, they set up on the hill for about an hour, getting paid for it. And, you know, you need an hour, about 3 hours. We thought, you know, it just don't work for the...
Okay. I have a comment there then. That is saying safety is not as important as production, which...
I'm not saying that.
Well,
I'm saying that
that's what I'm hearing when you... I understand. Okay.
I'm putting nobody's life in jeopardy if we don't ever get run again.
Good. That's what. So, are we monitoring the atmosphere before we enter each time?
Yes, sir.
All right. We know what is safe to enter, and you're monitoring the stay times for people based on the temperature.
Yes, sir.
Okay. And it's posted as a confined space.
Well, it's not posted, but all my employees know it's a confined space, but I can get it posted.
Well, that is a requirement. Okay.
When we are building these new structures above ground, we have this issue with our parts. They're not uniform from one place to another, so we can't interchange our parts. Is there anything that we could do when we build these new systems? I mean, we're just taking what's existing and raising it up. We're not actually creating a new system where we could make the systems more uniform. I mean, is there any way we could do that?
The vacuum pump part is pretty uniform. Where you get into not being uniform is like a sewage pump when you're dealing with head pressure, you know, pumping through a force main that's 5 or 6 miles long versus one that's only 300 yards long. They're all different horsepower pumps.
Okay.
So that's where the difference is coming out there. But I will say this budget that we have this year actually has enough parts and pieces as far as the sewage pump part of it. We'll only be lacking one pump of having a replacement for everything.
And then I think you did address this, but as they are working on one of the stations, it's just a matter of flipping a switch and we're fine. We don't, as far as downtime goes.
That's the way it's going to have to be. So that's something we have to really push with the engineer, and they'll be aware of it too. And it's got to be mainly where you just flip a transfer switch and switch over to the new system.
This other independent engineer that we may find to take a look at all of this, I'd like to ask them also to take a look at the retention tank above ground, just so that we can see how much that would be. Not that we might do it, but just so we can have the information.
Well, that'd be something I'd like to ask, but I really don't know if it's possible.
Okay.
You do have a grade issue. It is called a gravity assist vacuum, you know, so that's the reason the collection tank is actually flooding there now. Even if you go to some of these other communities, the only thing at the top of their buildings are electrical components, they still have the sewage tank below ground.
Okay.
Any more commissioners' comments, questions? Thank you very much, sir, for your hard work and your committee's hard work.
Yes.
Vice Chair Vicki Myers is going to give us a report on subdivision regulations.
Okay. At the May Board of Commissioners meeting, you asked the Planning and Zoning to review the subdivision regulations in the town's ordinances and make a recommendation to the Board of Commissioners to address size and combining of lots. We did that. We reviewed the subdivision ordinances and found that the town's ordinances are based on the state statutes and that allows lots to be combined. The subdivision regulations don't address structure size. However, while not covered in the subdivision regulations, there are other restrictions that are already in place that limit structures. And what we're suggesting, and this is all in your letter there, that we are suggesting that P&Z create a summary of the restrictions that are already on the books. For example, for oceanfront properties, there's the CAMA setbacks. Anything over 5,000 feet would require 120 foot. We restrict the lot coverage to 30%. There's, depending on where you are on the island, there's other restrictions. We would also like to hear from you guys a little bit more direction regarding the task to address size, and whether you are requesting that we review lot size or the structure size or some other particular concern. P&Z has been looking at this issue on and off for over 2 years now, and you know, it just seems like we're kind of dancing around it, so it'd be better for us if you would just go ahead and tell us what you're thinking.
I'll tell you what I'm thinking. I focus on structure size, and there's a lot of, I like your suggestion. There's contributing factors to limit structure size, and I wholeheartedly agree with your recommendation. I'd like to see a list of those contributing factors. I'd also like to see notated which ones are town ordinances or laws.
And basically,
who controls each one of those contributing factors. Right.
Okay. Any other questions or anything? I mean, we can talk about Senate Bill 25, you know, that limits number of bedrooms, but it doesn't look like, it looks like you could put a square footage in there.
When you say something limits the number of bedrooms?
Senate Bill 25 that was passed last year, a lot of surrounding communities used number of bedrooms to limit the size of structures. Senate Bill 25 took that out.
Oh, that's what I thought. You can't do that now, right?
Right. You do not limit it based on the room dimensions or anything like that. However, right. You can do it based on other North Carolina municipalities. They limit the maximum square footage. Some of them use floor area ratio, where they'll look at the floor area divided by the lot size. The percent impervious that we've already talked about, we're currently 30% for floodwater, stormwater. My point is, there's a lot of different options. And if I kind of had an idea where you were trying to go with this, we could get there quicker.
Well, my thought was that we would limit, say, to 5,000 square feet or some mass amount of a building. Just looking forward to if somebody bought a 500-foot lot and built this monstrosity, might be their own home, could be. But I don't see that being Holden Beach. I see this. We've got a couple of new 3,200-square-feet beautiful homes, and I know we've got at least a couple of 5,000-square-feet homes that they're great. They're plenty big to have lots of bedrooms. But that was my view, that we would look to something limit. And I think the South Carolina, did you know South Carolina have a state law for on the beaches, on the islands, that they have a 5,000 square foot limit? I think so.
We looked at a year and a half or so ago when we were looking at this issue. We did look at different communities all up and down the coast of the U.S. because it's the whole mega structure is not unique to here. You know, it's going on everywhere. So. We did look at those, and it varies drastically by state and municipalities within the states.
Yeah, I don't know what. To me, there's nothing magic about 5,000 square feet. So I'd like to know, what options, and like I said, the contributing factors, and maybe we only have a couple. You know, maybe it's so narrow that 5,000 square feet could never be built anyway, because of some other reasons. So I'd like to understand the problem before I give you a number of square feet that I want to limit. Because to me, that's providing a solution before I know the problem.
Right. you know, on the oceanfront, for example, in our meeting, the pier came up, the pier property being for sale, could somebody put in some kind of a hotel? I mean, besides our height limits, I mean, that those properties will be impacted by the CAMA setback rules. That if they're over 5,000 square feet, then they're going to have to sit back 120 feet from the line of vegetation. So,
so
kind of making that impossible.
So maybe that's where the 5,000 square feet is coming from. So I'd like to know that, you know, if that's a limit of setback,
CAMA.
CAMA. So that's a number that then means something to us. But otherwise, so maybe there's other numbers that will flush out that will have a logical limit or mean something to us.
Okay.
Okay.
Are you going to task us again or?
I'd say yes. I'd say your recommendation. In your third paragraph.
Okay.
It's sufficient for me.
Well, because it may be that we already have things on the books to control the size of the homes.
Right.
And this irrational fear of we're going to have some giant hotel is irrational. So
right.
That would be nice to know. And then we don't have to come up with some hard set rule because we have already taken care of it.
Right.
Because we don't want to limit building on the island. We don't want to just send the message that we hate big houses. I mean, that's not it.
Well, right, and that's kind of where I'm coming from is I feel like for the most part, and I know Rhonda can probably address this, you know, much better than I have, the center part of the island is already narrowing. And, you know, it'd be really hard to put that big of a house in there. So just kind of bear that in mind. The other thing I kicked around in my mind was should we do a little financial analysis along with that to see what the impact would be? You know, Rhonda could tell us how many homes did we have that were being built over 5,000. If they were reduced to 5,000, what would the impact on property taxes be and that kind of thing? I mean, it seems like whenever we make a rule, we should look at the financial implications.
Yeah, I mean, you know, when we originally looked at this, it was the mega house, right? And it was more of a how a structure is being used, not the size. So I don't want to restrict anybody from doing anything as far as how they build their homes. So I just really want to understand the issue more than anything.
Well, and the ends of the island are already impacted because, you know, they're in different erosion zones than the center part of the island. So, I mean, I think that Kim's point is well taken and that there's not a whole lot of spots that oceanfront-wise that would be suitable for a mega house other than the ends of the islands, and they're already restricted. So
right. Okay.
The lots that are not oceanfront and are able to be combined could be a different story. But there could be other tweaks that we could do if that's what you're worried about.
Yes, that would be nice.
Okay. Just so you know, we certainly weren't tasking you to bring us another rock. We didn't like the way this one looked at. Look like. But I will say it is, I think at least what I struggle with is I've seen where we have subdivision plans like the large area that's Griffin, I call it Griffin Park, I probably that's not it, but the that was donated.
Yes, the
and
marsh.
Yes, the marsh, yeah. But there's actually a subdivision map for that.
That's
platted, which to me indicates that at some point there was a plan for that. So I don't know what the plan is now. And that's why I felt planning and zoning is the perfect place to look at what is the plan and is that plan in accordance with what the statutes are. So maybe we can just answer the question by, you know, give us a summary of those existing codes.
Okay.
I don't know if our town attorney is involved in this in terms of what are legal strategies that communities use because, you know, we are a family beach.
Right.
But that could change quickly if someone smart enough money comes in and looks at everything and says, well, gee, I can do this. And to me, that's part of a function of, you know, planning and zoning, that you aren't just reacting based on the next person that comes in and wants to wants to do something that could significantly alter the character of the beach.
Right. Well, I mean, you guys know me. I'm like the big proponent of everything should be planned so far in advance that it...
Yeah, exactly.
Thank you.
Thanks, ma'am. Chris Clemens, Disaster Debris Manager.
Pleasure and wonderful pudding that I love so dear.
Good evening. How you doing? I'll try to make this a little faster, being our book so thick. You'll probably remember back in, I think it was March, I actually came to you and gave you the option of joining Brunswick County in a multi-jurisdictional solicitation of a contractor to do storm debris cleanup and storm debris monitoring. Brunswick County actually done the solicitation, and they've actually awarded that contract to Crowder Gulf for storm debris management, and they also awarded a contract to Landfall Strategies. Both of those companies have a pretty thick resume from what I'm looking at. Looks like they've been involved in doing storm cleanup from New Jersey all the way to the Gulf. Seem to be pretty qualified in the way everything is now with FEMA. It's really something that you have to actually have in place before you have an event in order to qualify for FEMA reimbursement. I'm asking the board to consider approving them as our debris contractors also.
Is there a motion?
I have a question. What is there cost already defined in this contract, or is it floating, or what?
It's no cost to us unless we actually have an event, and all of that would actually be associated with the storm. This would actually be just like that we had our own standalone contractor, and we could activate this contract at any time. What it does in a bid, it actually locks them in to a tonnage price, and everything is actually edged in stone, and you don't have to, I know this probably sounds like a bad word, but somebody can't really gouge as far as price. And
so if there's a storm,
the FEMA, the reimbursement rates are established by FEMA.
Okay.
Back in the day, back before we had Katrina, you know, I could stop anybody out here on the street that had a dump truck and then offer them a job and keep up with the paperwork, and you'd get paid. Well, now, if you ain't got all your T's crossed and your I's dotted, you may not get anything.
What's the county's, involvement as far as paying for anything? Nothing?
It's the same arrangement. We're just allowed to piggyback. They did all the legal work.
Okay.
And we're just piggybacking on their contract.
So that answers my other question. So attorneys have reviewed this, and okay, great. Thanks.
When we actually also solicited and tried to do our own bidding process, and we had zero response.
Because nobody paid attention, right?
Nobody paid attention or didn't qualified eyes didn't lay on the paper.
Great. Okay, thanks.
All right.
Mr. Hewitt. Do you expect or want any action on this tonight?
I'd request the board approve us piggybacking on the county's contract.
I make a motion that we do that.
Is there second. Any official discussion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. Madam Clerk, it's unanimous. Thank you, Mr. Clemens. Number 13 on the agenda is possible approval of Ordinance 16-10, amending the ordinances, Chapter 7, Traffic Code, Chief Wiley Lane.
This is actually an extremely simple modification to the ordinance, and it only pertains to Ranger Street. And as a result of a meeting or so ago, the board was informed of some issues that folks in that area had with the current parking situation. So what we got together and decided was that based on the amount of space, we would designate parking for vehicles, golf carts, and beach equipment. And each of those locations would be designated by signs. And essentially, the ordinance says if you violate what the sign says, you'll be cited for it. And that's the extent. It's just a modification of what was already in the ordinance pertaining to Ranger Street. Any questions?
Yeah, question. So the exception does not change, or does it? Does exception change the statement regarding Ranger, no parking within 25 feet of any intersection?
It does not. This is beyond that.
Okay.
That 25 feet still stays. Yep.
Ranger is a tiny little street that comes right off of Ocean Boulevard and goes directly to the walkway, and there's nothing on it. And it just seemed to make sense on one side of it to designate spots for golf carts, and on the other side to put in concrete stops to designate where cars should park, so we don't have cars running over, you know, things in the ground they shouldn't be running into, and then to make a section where people who are walking to the beach can leave their bikes, can lock their bikes, and then get to that walkway. There's nothing else around there. And it seems like if you designate the parking, then you could get more people into that section as well.
I think so. I think it's a pretty good solution to a neighborhood problem. And I think those folks are pretty happy about it, too. I know the town manager met with the folks and kind of sort of discussed what we were thinking, and they were most pleased.
Good. Do we see any, I'll rephrase that. Does this set a precedent that others could question? For example, why don't we have designated parking for golf carts?
There's two other very similar streets, and that it may have applicability on. There's two other short streets close by, that this may be the template for that, but we don't know until we try it at this location.
No one else has come forward and said anything at this point, but anything's possible once they see what happens on Ranger Street.
Well, I think the difference is there's space there for the parking.
Right.
You know, it's not in that 25 feet that we've designated at the road for safety purposes. You still can't park there. But there is space there available for cars.
Parking is
limited.
Yeah, you can get several cars in there, several golf carts, the bikes and the other beach equipment. It's actually a perfect spot for all those things.
I have no other questions.
Okay. I'd like to make a comment about that, if I could.
Give me the gavel, Mr. Penn.
I certainly don't want to be out of order. I would recommend that the town consider wording this almost ordinance, or considered ordinance change, because Ranger Street intersects Hillside Drive on the south end of Ranger Street, and the technicality is that some of the parking and activities that you're dealing with carries over into Hillside Drive. So just making you aware of that in case you want to correct that.
And that's the road under the dune?
Part of it is.
So what you're saying is as it stands right now, it's not technically correct.
Yes, sir.
Then I would, turn the gal back over to you.
Then is it all right for me to talk now?
That's a fairly simple change.
Do we understand how, so we can modify the ordinance to
Could it be by change of wording now?
Yeah, we could absolutely do that.
If you tell me specifically in your motion what you would like to change it to, we can change it.
Yep, absolutely could. Just include what the mayor said. In addition to Ranger Street, that also involves Hillside Drive. And the parking would be designated just like we said, but it covers both streets.
I'm not an attorney, but I'll tell you what I think needs to be said. What you want to say, I believe, is that Ranger Street extended southward through the right-of-way of Hillside Drive.
Well, I move we approve the motion as amended.
Second.
Well, I'm moving that, I'm making a motion we approve the ordinance, sorry, as amended.
All right. Everybody understand where we are?
Yeah.
For a second.
Second.
Got a second. Further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say nay. Thank you, Chief.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Commissioner Freer, beat security, number 14 on the agenda.
Okay. As we discussed earlier, everybody knows there's a constant challenge of awareness and the challenge of enforcing the town beach ordinances. And I spoke about this before. I don't know the best model to adopt that other municipalities are using. Therefore, I propose that the police present an evaluation of a part-time beach patrol. I think Sunset has that. And I'd also like to have the Park and Rec Committee in their next meeting add an agenda to do something similar, an evaluation of a beach ambassador program. I think there's other nearby beach communities that do the same. The sign, great improvement. Whoever thought of that, I commend. But I think we need to, supplement, the police. We only have 8 police on the beach. It's hard to get that coverage on the beach in the summers. We work a lot of overtime. A lot of people, the officers have to, they're in their flak jackets and patrolling the beach as much as we would like is, I think, unrealistic. So I'd like, it's two things, right? How the under the beach, under the police umbrella or under the Parks and Recs umbrella.
So is that an action we're to consider, Commissioner Freer?
Yes.
So that's a motion.
It's a motion to ask the police for the recommendation and the Parks and Rec for the recommendation.
I just wanted to clarify because the agenda for the Parks and Rec Board for this week, because we meet on Thursday, has already gone out.
Yep.
Are you asking for us to amend the agenda at the meeting and include this or wait for the July meeting?
No, I'm asking you to amend the agenda.
Okay. We have a motion. Did I hear a second?
I second.
Okay. Any more discussion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. Thank you, Mr. Freer. Mr. Hewitt, are you going to speak to number 15?
In a nutshell, the chapel would like to make the sodded area adjacent to Rothschild Street and Brunswick Avenue no parking at the corner of the chapel there. That's pretty much what they're asking, is to make that area no parking. That is the request.
And is that under the right of way?
That is in the right of way.
I would ask the commissioners to give consideration that Ms. Jane Edwards be able to address this. She is in charge of the grounds at Holden Beach Chapel. Would that be okay?
Sure, sure. Mm-hmm.
She was here. Is she here?
She's right there. Okay.
Oh, I didn't, she moved.
All Thank you for all your hard work.
Yes.
Thank you. Where I'm coming from is that for the last 12 years, there has been a rebar and plastic fence put down there that was not legal, not illegal. It was just there. And as long as it was there, we didn't have a parking problem. The chapel keeps up four parking lots, which are open for anybody to use at any point in time. We also pay the maintenance on all four of those parking lots. We keep the one across Brunswick mowed. We keep the chapel in good shape. We spend a considerable amount of money on the beautification of the chapel. And the fence that had been there, which was temporary, had really become a liability to the chapel and the town. And it was ugly. But we have taken it down. We have put up some temporary things along Brunswick that some of you might have seen. Those, again, do not fall within the right thing that we're supposed to do with the town on the right-of-way. And so there just doesn't seem to be a way to do it that it solves any of the problems. And so the only way that the chapel has come up with that we can do it is if we would call that area no parking. I think the chapel really, if people started parking on that area and all, the chapel can't continue to keep the grounds looking like they do. So that's our reason for asking for the no parking area.
So there's grass planted in that area?
Mm-hmm. All of it is. And the 25-foot going from Rothschild to Ocean Boulevard is no problem. There's a no parking sign there. There's a one no parking sign by the water hydrant on the corner of Rothschild and Brunswick. There aren't no parking signs on the 25 feet that go either direction from the intersection. And we're actually looking for not the area in front of the parsonage, but from simply the property line where the chapel starts on Brunswick around to the drive in and out of where the portico goes.
Everybody understand?
Yeah. Is the issue that there's sprinklers? Did I read the sprinklers are in there in the right of way?
There are sprinklers in there. There are plants in there.
But the sprinklers are in the right of way.
The sprinklers probably are. I'm not sure. I'm sorry.
On the edge, maybe.
The majority of the sprinklers are not in the right of way. There. But there are one or two that could be, but the majority of them are not.
My question might be for all of us is, in doing this, do we cause any issues with any other housing developments or anything? And now I think about Marker 55, is that a private community? Because I think I tried to drive in and was told I couldn't drive in. Can subdivisions do that?
If they're planted that way, they can.
Only if they're...
There are private subdivisions.
Doomscape's private. There are others that aren't?
Yeah.
Because when I first got elected, I looked over the old minutes and I saw one of the developments down the West End had asked for this, a no parking in their development area, and were denied. And I wondered, does this open up the issue that you would give it to somebody like that, to another development? You'd give them the same kind of right or not? Can we do it just for the chapel?
Yes, sir.
Sure, we can do it. Well, the chapel's really unique, right? It's got parking lots. It's
right,
used
yep.
by the town.
Yep, yep. I don't have an issue with that.
But with all that said, I think we should look at each one individually. Just like the chapel's unique, you know, there could be some uniqueness to the others. I think they should all be looked at on its own merit.
We might expect to do that. I'm fine with doing the chapel.
Yeah, I am too.
I just have a question. Is this legally, are we within bounds to implement this?
Not certain that I fully understand that other than we're posting no parking signs in the right way. I mean, you're not amending the ordinance that, just like you just amended the ordinance for Ranger, you're not amending an ordinance. This would not amend your existing ordinance approving
Yeah, this is just discussing raising the issue to the board.
Right. My question was, are we changing the conditions with which we place no parking signs in right-of-ways? I mean, I understand, for example, 25 feet from the intersection, I understand that. Are we setting precedent here that is legally supported?
I think that the town has the right to designate no parking areas,
okay,
where it would so choose to do,
okay,
that within the public right-of-way. You would have to have rationale to do that.
You would have to have rationale, yes. I mean, you've got broad legislative authority, but we're not amending. This letter is not a proposal to amend the existing ordinance that addresses where there is parking and not parking on streets within the town's.
But we do have one, right, that does that, identifies all of the no parking areas?
Yes.
Do we need to amend that? Do we need to amend that for you to do this?
Yes. Right now, if somebody wanted to go park on the chapel's grass, they could, and Wally could not tow them or write them a ticket. They could go up there and spin the tires and...
Because we haven't decreed that to be a no parking.
That is a parking area, except within 25 feet of this corner there.
So as I understand it, we need...
Not to just post a no parking sign.
If it's the town's property, the town can post a no parking sign, but you have an ordinance. There are two different questions being asked. One is, are you setting a precedent? And you've got a parking ordinance that we've just amended to exclude or to include, allow parking on Ranger south to Hillside Drive, if I got that right, that sets out where parking is prohibited. So if you are adding a place where parking is prohibited in the most consistent manner so that anybody visiting the town would have the ability to pull up the town's ordinances and say, you know, that parking is prohibited here in addition to posting the sign, you would amend parking. Okay.
I think that what we're trying to say is that we would bring, if the board would like to make that a no parking area, we would bring back an ordinance to the board that says, from the corner of Ocean Boulevard, Rothschild, 100 feet west, to a point 100 feet west, and likewise on Rothschild Street, okay, whatever those distances are.
Right, could based we not on what move I heard, that now?
No.
Well, no. I wouldn't recommend doing that one on the fly. We should measure those, and we probably need to have the chief to do a little site triangulation also with what goes on there.
Okay, based on what I've heard, I move that we consider at our next regular meeting an ordinance that authorizes the installation of no parking signs at the chapel as directed by this letter.
But it's not just no parking signs, it's developing no parking zone.
Is that what you meant to say?
Yes, that's exactly.
Is there a second?
I second it.
Yeah, I got that. We got it.
Any more discussion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. It's unanimous, Madam Clerk. Thank you, Ms. Edwards. Number 16, discussion and possible approval of Ordinance 16-11, Christy Ferguson.
Good evening, everyone. As you guys know, over the Memorial holiday, the inlet was dredged. Money from that, two-thirds of the cost, was out of the North Carolina Division of Water Resources Fund. The county paid $50,000 of that up front and asked both Oak Island and us to share in the cost of that, which would be $12,500 from both Oak Island and from us. And then they would pay $25,000 towards the remainder local share. The best way for us to appropriate those funds, since we didn't have a Lockwood Folly dredging line item in the budget this year, would be to move or decrease the Beach Nourishment Fund $12,500 by ordinance and increase the Lockwood Folly dredging by $12,500. And that's because with this dredging, we were not able to have beneficial use of the placement on the beach with the sand, because the Merritt was the only dredge available, so it was transportation purposes only. If we were going to use the Merton and then put sand on the beach, then it could be considered beach nourishment.
Move approval of ordinance number 16-11.
Is there a second?
Second.
Discussion? Hearing none, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. It's unanimous, Madam Clerk. Number 17, Ms. Ferguson, if you'll address.
The Central Reach Interlocal Agreement, that we brought that before you guys last month. The county at their meeting, directly before our meeting, I think they met on Monday evening, we met on Tuesday, wanted more time to look at the agreement to make sure it was legally sound for both parties. The agreement that the county passed on the 31st of May is in front of you, and I would recommend approval of that agreement to solidify as a backstop for our Central Reach project with the county.
I move that we approve the town-county interlocal financing agreement with the Central Reach project.
Second, anybody?
Second.
Discussion? Hearing none, all in favor?
I'm sorry, Ms. Mayor. Just a question, and I may be out of order just to ask this. The, you know, our budget that we will be considering later this evening, quickly. We talked about reducing our fund balance, and we were briefed during a workshop that that has potential effect on cost of borrowing money. This interlocal agreement and our budget will, in fact, implement that reduction in our fund balance. Is that correct?
So it will only implement the reduction in the fund balance if you pass the budget.
Correct. Right. Yes, thank you. Right. Okay. All right.
Okay. No further questions. Ready to vote. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. Unanimous, Madam Clerk. And Ms. Ferguson, you want to roll?
Thank you for putting me all together so I could stand up here.
Number 18.
Continuing on the Central Reach topic, we're required to set a public hearing. So this memo requests that the Board of Commissioners set a public hearing for your regular meeting of August 16, 2016 to consider establishing a municipal service district for the Central Reach project.
So move.
Questions, discussion? None. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed say no. It's unanimous again. You got 100% approval of everything you wanted tonight.
Well done. Yeah.
Number 19. Mr. Hewitt, do you want to talk about this lawsuit? We're not involved.
Emerald is requesting that all North Carolina beach communities assist with funding in the matter of Nye's versus Town of Emerald. This is a case concerning littoral rights. The North Carolina Supreme Court has granted discretionary review, which will take place in mid-July. Specifically, at issue is the right of the public to use the dry sand beach, which has been the historical and traditional public practice by right. Known local governments that, as of the current, participating are Southern Shores, Dare County, Wrightsville Beach, Indian Beach, North Topsail, Pine Knoll Shores, Nags Head, Duck, Curry Beach is entertaining the motion tonight, and Brunswick County is also considering soon. The amount requested is $2,000. And I know the attorney is probably going to kick me, but I say in my memo here, this would be an example of bad law if the Supreme Court overturns what is, in essence, the existing public trust doctrine. And I think that the broader implications for North Carolina in general and consequences associated therein for Holden Beach would justify the town's monetary support.
What are your thoughts, Commissioner?
Does doing this add our name to a lawsuit?
It would just contribute to paying the legal expenses. The amicus brief.
Right. I mean, the $2,000, I think, is, you know, not much. It's really they want our name against on that brief. That's what they're asking for. I don't know if we know enough about it. I certainly couldn't read that 31-page document. I don't know if our attorney has and has a opinion.
I'll give you my summary of the case, which I don't have the case in front of me, but this is a lawsuit that resulted from, in part, from an ordinance that that had to do with an ordinance that dealt with driving on the beach in part, and there was a dispute as to whether or not the property owners adjacent to the dry sand beach owned that subject to the public's right to traverse it. So that typically in North Carolina, which is not the case on all beaches on the East Coast or West Coast in North Carolina, citizens have had the ability to be on the wet sand beach and also on the dry sand beach. And these individuals who, they started the lawsuit with a bunch of people, but only one group appealed knives. But the Court of Appeals found in, say, October of last year that the Superior Court in the county where this was litigated was correct in awarding the town summary judgment, finding that the historical practice of citizens of North Carolina or visitors to North Carolina to use and access the dry sand beach was a fundamental practice that should not be challenged. And these folks have now appealed it to the Supreme Court of North Carolina seeking a determination that the Court of Appeals was an error. So what the plaintiff in this case wants is to be able to, and I'm really outside of their particulars, but essentially they want to be able to put up a fence at the dry sand and say, you can't step on my sand. If there's a turtle that you want to look at, you can't look at it. If there is a conch shell on the dry sand beach, that's my conch shell because it's on my dry sand in front of my property. So the town of Emerald Isle has sent out through their manager to all coastal managers, also all town lawyers, and pretty much any listserv that lawyers that represent coastal communities participate on, requesting $2,000 to contribute to a brief that would have the names on the coastal of the coastal towns that contributed to show the Supreme Court that there is wide support for the public trust rights to dry sand beach.
You know, I also am not a lawyer, but I can't imagine why the Supreme Court decided to hear this case.
It sounds like a frivolous lawsuit to me.
I'm certain that the town of Emerald Isle's attorney would agree with you, but it did make it to the Court of Appeals, and now it's going to go to the Supreme Court, potentially going to the Supreme Court. So the request is for all municipalities to contribute $2,000 towards the joint brief that will be written.
I'm not hearing any action. I'm getting ready to move to the next item on the agenda. No action means no action. Number 20, discussion and possible action on Ordinance 1612. That's our budget, and we talked about on number 8. We talked about the closing of this year's fiscal year budget. Now we're going to be looking at the upcoming year, and Mr. Hewitt, you got anything else you want to say on that?
Only that this is the proposed spending plan for the upcoming year. Is it?
but it includes revenues, of course.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. It equals zero. Yeah, it
equals zero. I just want to make sure I heard.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
I'm listening check.
Any commissioners want to say anything?
I want to ask the attorney if she agrees with me. The majority of this budget includes the Central Reach project of a $15 million expenditure. That's, to me, very significant. And as I own a house on the beach, which may be affected in value one way or the other, I felt I probably should recuse myself from voting on this item. Do you think would you agree I have a conflict of interest? Then I will vote.
And I'll pile on that. With that analogy, all commissioners are property owners and thereby impacted by the property tax.
It's like paving a highway.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
All right.
So this is us approving the budget.
Mr. Hewitt?
Yes, sir.
But I do have one question. We have an addendum, a 10-year long-range planning spending plan.
Well, it is a capital improvement budget. Plan.
Right.
Okay. It is not an executable budget. In the only budgetary execution is in the ordinance, which is year one of the capital plan. The rest of it is not an executable budget.
And therefore, we're not actually approving anything on year 2 through 10.
You're approving that as the capital plan as an attachment to the budget. But you can't spend any money.
Only
on
as a
it.
Plan.
As a plan, that's right.
This is minor, but it caught my attention. This was the first I'd heard of the Bridgeview Public Dock fees. Mm-hmm. Are those fees comparable to similar facilities in our neighboring communities?
As best that we can come up with, in accordance with what Fish and Wildlife guidance has given us and what we can cast as far as a benchmark to other places. And since this is the first year of that, we don't know if they're going to be correct, but I think they're close enough to get started with.
And was this in the original plan to construct the Bridgeview Public Dock?
It's a requirement to charge a fee for certain components of it.
All right.
I just have a couple comments. I'm ready to vote for this budget tonight, and I wanted to thank David and the department heads for all their work on developing this budget. It's very difficult to say yes to a tax increase. Very difficult for me to say yes to that, but I am going to and am prepared to adopt this budget tonight. But I would like for us to think about this upcoming year and maybe changing our process a little bit. When we had our budget meetings, we sat up here and David presented to us, and David, it felt a lot like a hearing, like we were cross-examining David, and it was his budget and not our budget. So I think if there's a way we can work next year toward developing a process where we don't wait until April or May, we start much earlier, and we have workshops where we are around a table, and we work with the department heads, and we work with David, and the commissioners are there, and we go line by line and really examine this budget, that would make me feel, and I know the voters feel much better about this being our budget. And I would like to see us start with these workshops, I would say within the next couple of months. So I don't, know how the other commissioners feel about this idea at all, but I'm very willing to work up something and bring it to the next meeting.
Yeah, I totally agree with that concept. And even next month, the special meeting, just to talk process, just to, you know, I agree with what you said. It needs to be a workshop. It needs to be everyone's budget. You know, again, David did a lot of work. Everybody did a lot of work. Much appreciated. But, you know, it's my first budget in the process. You know, I'd like to be more involved. So maybe we can have a special meeting sometime soon while it's all fresh in our minds, and incorporate our new audit committee on that as well.
And maybe give the audit committee a little better direction on what we expect from them.
Yes. Yep. Yep. I also have some other comments. You know, there's a lot of positives. You know, we've got the inspection department now increasing fees to what other municipalities charge, and they're paying for themselves. We increasing block rate structure for water, even though it's going to cost me more money. It's a great idea. So and it's in line with the other communities. I mean, it's good that we're not facing the 9.5 cents that we thought, but it's tough saying that 7 cent tax increase is good. But it is. You know, there's the biggest thing that jumps out at me is the very low fund balance available of 19%. That is scary. And we're down with, you know, we're the second to the last on municipalities in the area. You know, to that, we definitely need to adjust how we're doing things to rectify that, because you know, it's going to force us not to be able to do things. You know, it's forcing us to borrow money for Central Reach. Who knows, if we do things differently, we may have had that money for Central Reach in the BPART fund, and it's gonna greatly impact our ability to do anything else in the near future, because the funds basically are just not there. So I would like to, you know, to increase that, to make the funds available, so if we want to do things that need to be done, we have the capability of doing this.
Mr. Hewitt, the discussion has covered the subject of the Central Reach, but would you give a brief explanation of how this budget includes or does not include any funding for consideration of the Holden Beach Fishing Pier or the Griffin property under the bridge or the terminal groin?
There's $130,000 in the budget to complete the permitting of the terminal groin. A residual of $2 million is left in BPART fund balance, and the terminal groin construction is in year 3 of the capital plan. There are no funds budgeted or considered for purchase of the Griffin property or the Holden Beach Fishing Pier.
Okay. Any more questions or comments from the board? Are you ready to vote? Mm-hmm. We did have a motion, didn't we?
Move we adopt the budget.
Second.
Presented.
Right. Motion and a second. Yeah, we're out of order here. Talking about before we had a motion. Yeah. All right. You need to spank me over there.
I failed you.
All right. Any more discussion? If not, all in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed say no. It's unanimous. Madam Clerk. Number 21, Town Manager's Report.
Uh, I don't know if anybody saw the activity taking place at Ocean, the juncture of Jordan Boulevard and Ocean Boulevard East today, but over the last few days, there's been some construction going on there. There's going to be an electric vehicle charging station, courtesy of Nissan and Brunswick Electric. The equipment has been installed free of charge, along with the installation, and free power for a year, and then converting to some type of a vending charging systems. No cost to the town, no cost to the taxpayers.
Is that the first in the area or county?
No. They're setting up a series coming from the south, Myrtle Beach, and I believe there's one at Ocean Isle Beach.
But it's nice. That should be on our websites and everything, so electric vehicles come on the vacation here.
It is.
If they can get here, they can get back.
What today?
Okay.
Clarify that whether that's for cars only or for golf carts, too.
It's a special electrical connection for cars. And the way that they scope the type of equipment, they figured if you're going to come to the beach, you're probably going to be there for 4 to 6 hours, so that's the charge rate on the equipment down there. They had some faster charge type of equipment, but they just went with the, I think it's about $25,000 system down there.
The state would then convert to vending. Is that the town converting to vending?
Brunswick Electric.
Okay. So
yeah.
It's an electric gas station.
It's pretty so much.
This is no cost to us.
It's a convenience.
For the service.
Nothing.
All right. Excellent. I'll go ahead and buy my Tesla.
Yeah. for those of you that have missed Tim Evans for the last couple weeks, he'll be out for about 6 more weeks, and very qualified Bill Bruce will be filling in for him on a contractual basis. Along the lines of inspections and planning and zoning, I'm deleting that one. This one didn't have it. X'd out, Heather handed me a substitute.
David, if you, I'll speak for all of us and we can object not to. Would you pass on to Tim Evans that we miss him and we wish him well?
Sure, would I. The 885 Ocean Boulevard West looks like that had a close encounter with a car here. Recent past, and we're working on the repair there, going through the insurance bit, their insurance, our insurance. So we're working on a repair. We want to get that done as soon as we can because that's a high traffic area and everybody's mad because we've had to block it off so you can't get there, but we want to get that fixed quick. Lockwood Folly Inlet Crossing Maintenance Dredging, the Chief of Navigation with the Corps has made inquiry of us to see if there's any interest in participating on the piggyback with the Corps this winter. And I've had some questions go back to them before we can cost it, or I can bring anything to the board concerning what types of quantities they're looking at, whose permit will it use, and also what type of burden share will the state be thinking of helping us with through the memorandum of agreement. Speaking of the state's memorandum of agreement, there is a move afoot to extend that MOA from its current to 10 years. Right now it's supposed to expire in about 18 months, I believe, but it's originally was issued for 5 years and want to move that out to 10. That's currently in the Attorney General's office, and the funding cap, we're trying to get that increased from $4 million to $12 million that the Division of Environmental Quality will have put in their coffers for the purpose of doing these burden-sharing shallow draft inlet funding type projects. The Central Reach Project, that pre-bid conference was held week before last. And we had the big three in attendance, Great Lakes, Cottrell, and Mason. Those bids are due back the first part of July, and our easement work continues. Bridgeview Park, looks like the lights are on tonight. A lot of people having fun out there. Those lights go off at 10. And haven't had anybody complaining about all the noise and fun that's going on out there yet. The dock structures are complete. We're just waiting to have the Sandy Sailor and a couple of the utility connections made out there. Still remaining, of course, is the rest of the stormwater, laying down sod tomorrow, I believe, and then the sidewalk shortly thereafter. That would be the finishing of the first phase of it. And, of course, the PARTIF grant is in this year's budget. And that construction, we're not going to try to do anything in this summertime, but that would be a fall and winter type construction. DOT bridge landscaping, it looks a lot better than it did. They're still not finished yet. And in case I spoke out of school, there is no signage. I want to correct myself for everybody. There's no signage or lights in that contract. And lastly, or almost next to last, we've received over the course of the last 6 months approximately $115,000 from Brunswick County loaning our excess sewer capacity to Southport. There's a move afoot for Southport to try to figure out if they want to build or buy capacity in the plant and in the county plant, and this short-term loan, if you will, has resulted in the town receiving a non-reliable, to-be-determined term revenue stream. In fact, the county manager told me that make sure you don't budget for that in your budget, because we don't know what Southport's going to do, but we'll take a $50,000 check every 6 months as long as our capacity holds up. I just want to, the foot stomper here is that the town of Holden Beach has 1 million gallons of capacity in the West Regional Plant. It remains ineffective. It has been 1 million, and it will remain at 1 million. We're just allowing Southport to use some of the unused capacity in it, which, by the way that our water consumption is going up, it may not go up after we put this new sewer rate on it, but over the Memorial Day weekend, we had some 800,000-900,000 gallons a day water consumption. Of course, some of that gets consumed and doesn't flow out in terms of sewer. And lastly, the Embers will be here this weekend. Our entertainment marquee this year, we've upped our caliber of acts, and the Embers is just indicative of that. So it's summertime, in case you hadn't noticed, and a lot of people here at the beach. Thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Hewitt. The mayor has no comments or reports.
Can I ask a question of David?
Sure. Sure.
You talked about the pier, and Alan asked about the pier. Will you be bringing back some information to us about whether or not any organizations, the state or the county, might help? Because I saw today there's some increased in the funds available for parks and recs.
Yes.
Okay, that's one. The second was, are you aware that some of the Outer Bank Islands might be deciding to do renourishment in the summer?
Yes.
Okay. That's just ignoring the turtle issue and paying a fine instead? Or?
Their issue is one of weather on the Outer Banks. You know, you've got the graveyard of the Atlantic up there, and their issue is one of weather. It is so rough up there in the wintertime that really a cost benefit determination for them, what they would lose in terms of lost production with bad weather up there, you know, higher mobilization rates. I mean, that's what it comes down to.
Okay.
They actually have, their permits are written that they can dredge in the summertime due to not only the weather, but also the size of those projects. It's hard to get them done in just the wintertime season.
Any more questions and comments? Mr. Mayor Pro Tem?
Just briefly, I've been very pleased with the DOT bridge beautification project. It's a long time overdue. And appreciate the fact that we haven't funded a sign or lights, but I think there's a great opportunity for us to have a sign and lights at that location. I'll just leave it at that. And I want to thank Mr. Hewitt and the staff for their enduring our questions during the workshops for the budget for the next year. I found them to be very well prepared and able to speak to their department's needs. And I'll emphasize needs because I do sympathize and empathize with the fact that most of us are on a fixed income. And subject to what the economy could do, that fixed income could be somewhat less. So I just want to state that I didn't expect to be approving a tax increase when I considered running for commissioner, but I was convinced that with what we've done with the budget, it was the prudent thing to do. So thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Fair.
It's late. I've already made my comments. I agree with everything Ashley said. So thank you.
Ms. Eisenhower?
Just wanted, again, to say thank you for the work on the budget. That was a huge task. And also to thank the sewer committee because they worked extensive hours, and I appreciate what they came back with. It was very helpful. And I know that was a lot of work, and I appreciate the time that they spent in all of our committees. I commend you. Just want to also remind people that the second helping on Saturdays, they're taking up food from 7 to 12. And if you don't donate food to that, they do take monetary donations as well. It's a very worthy charity, and I hope that you all consider contributing.
Mr. Fletcher.
You can't disagree with anything that's been said so far. At our last meeting, I asked that we have a good turnout for this meeting because of the budget, and I am happy to see as many people here as there are. I'm very much in support of Commissioner Eisenhower's recommendation on workshops for next year involving the public as well to come in and see by department who the department is, what they do, what it costs, what our options are with each of the departments. I think we'll all learn, and you will also learn how the business functions and why it costs what it costs to run a town like this. So I thank you for coming out tonight, and I will hope that when we do those in the fall that you'll get actively involved with it. And I also will certainly second the efforts of the committee that looked at the sewer issues. It was a big issue for us. We knew it coming in. It is a major risk, and they did a tremendous job of investigating that. So thank you for that.
Thank you, Mr. Fletcher. You all have noticed, I'm sure, that Mr. Kaiser's not here tonight. Whenever the meeting schedule was changed, he made us aware at that time that he was obligated not to be here at this meeting. And anyway, that's the reason he's not here. So let's move along to public comments on anything you guys want to talk about. If you raise your hand, be recognized. Come to the podium to my right, give us your name and your address, and have at us. Anybody? Yes, ma'am.
I'm Dolly Mitchell at 132 Tarpon. I have a question of Chris, or anyone who can answer it, but I think he's the best man to answer this. If we didn't have sewer, say we had a major storm, Chris, and we didn't have sewer, would we still have water in the homes?
You have some basically two separate systems, but we don't have a collection system for it to go, that can cause a problem. So we probably should shut the water off if you didn't have sewer in your house.
Okay.
But if we don't have sewer, we can't be on the island, right?
Right.
If we don't have sewer, we have to vacate the island.
I guess where I'm going with this, and I know the committee's got enough to deal with, but I think if we have a major storm where it's going to affect the sewer, and the possibility is we cannot come back to our homes, there are ones of us who saved our septic systems to use for irrigation and other things. In looking at this for long term, are there options that we would have until a system could get back up and running? And I'm just, you know, that may be too far out and too much to look at, but if we have a major storm that's going to take the system down, I think we also need to look at that. And, you know.
I'll address that for you unless the commissioners change the town's policy. If the sewer system is down, the people are off the island, period. Okay.
We have a mandatory sewer connection ordinance.
Mm. Okay, anybody else? Well, does anybody want to adjourn this meeting?
So moved.
Second.
You don't want to?
All in favor say aye, and thank you all for being here.